So I believe we are live online. So your conversations are going out to the universe. I wanted to start with this opening song. And I find it a little bit complicated because it's in two parts. And there's a lower part and a higher part. And so I'll try singing through both parts. And then when we get to where we're going to sing it, you just choose whichever you want to do. Either one will be fine. And I'm going to get my breath. Now let us sing, 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 sing. Now let us sing, 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 sing. Lift up your hearts, be not afraid. Now let us sing to the power of the faith within. Now let's, so that's the low part. The high part is more like this. Now let us, I'm sorry, see I'm stuck on the low part. Start with the, sing to the power of the faith within. Sing to the power of the faith within. Lift up your hearts, be not afraid. Sing to the power of the faith within. See how easy that is if you're not me. So let's try singing this together. If we're on the first, this is the first page of the lyrics. If you want to stand, rise up in body and spirit, please do. If not, stay where you are. Lisa. Now let us sing, 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 sing. Now let us sing, 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 sing. Lift up your hearts, be not afraid. Let us sing to the power of the faith within. Now let us sing, 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 sing. Now let us sing, 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 sing. Lift up your hearts, be not afraid. Now let us sing to the power of the hope within. Now let us sing, 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 sing. Now let us sing, 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 sing. Lift up your hearts, be not afraid. Now let us sing to the power of the hope within. Now let us sing. Sing, sing, now let us sing. Sing, 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 lift up your hearts, be not afraid. Now let us sing to the power of the love within. Now let us sing, 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 sing. Now let us sing, 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 sing. Lift up your hearts, be not afraid. To the power of the joy within. Thank you very much. Please be seated. Good morning. Welcome to church this morning. My name is Khleber Van Zandt. I am the minister here at the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Venice, where we strive to be a beacon of liberal religion for Florida's Sun Coast and a refuge to all who seek a welcoming community, no matter your color, creed, ability, or class, no matter who you love, no matter your gender expression, your political affiliation, your religious belief, or lack of them. Here we celebrate our differences as we learn from one another. You could visit our website at uucov.org for information on upcoming programs like Meditation with Monk San each Saturday in this space, the monthly meetings of Plato's Circle and of Socrates Cafe, and the book club this month, I believe, is Reading the Power of Now by Eckhart Tolle. Is this correct? Thank you. Is there anyone who's back from the north for the first time in a while this morning? You're back from the north. I'll guess that your name is Henry Bright. welcome yet again. Is there anybody who's visiting for the first time who's brave enough to let us know you're here and your name if you wish? All right, so pick one.
I'm Karen.
Karen, do you live here? Where are you coming from? Here in Venice. Welcome today. Port Charlotte. Hi.
And I'm Carol.
Port Charlotte. Not so far down the road, is it? Very nice drive. Anybody else? Okay. Our prelude this morning is G from the first partita by Johann Sebastian Bach. This prelude will begin our worship. Call to worship comes from the feminist theologian Letty Russell. In hospitality, we discover that although there are among us, although there are among us real differences of race, age, gender, orientation, these differences are not a problem. It is not those differences between us that are separating us. It is rather our refusal to recognize those differences and to examine the distortions which result from our misnaming them and their effects upon human behavior and expectation. Let us worship together. Our first hymn is a belated Rosh Hashanah hymn, number 146, Soon the Day Will Arrive. And again, I would ask you to choose whether you're going to stand, rise, lie, whichever you wish. remain where you are. We have a responsive reading that I believe will be on the screens. This is entitled A Litany of Restoration. It is by the late Unitarian Universalist minister, the Reverend Marjorie Bowens Wheatley. If, recognizing the interdependence of all life, we strive to build community, the strength we gather will be our salvation. If you are black and I am white, if you are female and I am male, if you are older and I am younger, if you are progressive and I am conservative, if you are straight and I am gay, if you are Christian and I am Jewish, if we join spirits as brothers and sisters and siblings, the pain of our aloneness will be lessened, and that does matter. Our children have their own religious education class by Zoom each Sunday at 10 a.m. And if you'd like to attend or help your child to attend, you can find login information on our website at UUCOV or on our Facebook page. And now, if you've brought any celebrations with you to church this morning, I will bring you the mic and let you share briefly. Personally, and nonpartisanly, darn it, it's a long list. Celebrations.
The only celebration I have is to celebrate my memory. I have remembered what I said I would remember last week, and I will hold the snake up for you to look at. That is a book I have written of my memories, proof that even at my age I have a memory.
Only $20.
Well, along with Rosemary, I'm Rosalie Danbury, I would like to have good memories for another year lived in joy. I will be 83 tomorrow. And I celebrated by getting my car washed and by driving here by myself to enjoy your company.
I think that's our pleasure. Any other celebrations? Okay. And I'm only holding the mic because some of us still have cooties.
I have two sisters who are UU, long before I was, and every Sunday my sister in Wilmington, Delaware, calls me just before I leave the house to be sure I was going to church. Not to be sure, to ask if I'm going to church. I mean, but both of them were my older sisters, you know, so they pester me. They tell me and make sure I do what I should be doing.
Excellent. It's good to have that.
Good morning, I'm Valerie. I had a birthday this week.
Congratulations. Other celebrations. If you've brought any sorrows with you to church this morning, I will bring you the mic. No?
May the gratitude and celebrations among us this morning become a blessing to us all. May the concerns and sorrows of each be carried in all our hearts, a burden shared become a load lightened. Now let's join in a spirit of prayer and meditation. It will begin today with a prayer written by a Unitarian Universalist layperson named Diane Thompson. Spirit of life, spirit of love, in the stillness, hear my prayer. Grant me your presence. Show me not the way through, but the next step. Illuminate the darkness, not for all time, but for now. Open my heart to the love and beauty that surrounds me, if only I can find the strength to reach out. Open my heart also to the suffering and pain that is ever present. Lead me to a place of compassion and make me whole. We lift up those in this community who face change, challenge, or loss this day as we hold within our hearts all who suffer. And now we pray each in our own ways into the silence. The hopes of this community are offered forth in the names of all those who've gone before and in the names of all those who will come after, in the names of all the helpers of humankind. Shalom, salam, amen, and blessed be. Today's interlude will be introduced by our pianist, Lisa Frank.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
No, I had it on. I just needed to put it closer to my mouth. So Luis Jacalbo was born in 1882 and he died in 1945. He's one of the foremost Colombian composers. As a young man, his father abandoned his family and they were left in abject poverty. And they lived in a little town called Gambito in Bogota, Colombia. I've been there. When they moved to Bogota because looking for a better way of life. When he arrived, he got a job as a messenger boy for a store whose owner played piano. And this man was very generous and kind to young Luis and introduced him to the piano and gave him lessons, his first lessons. And his interest in music was kindled and it was discovered that he had a fine talent, and they put him in the municipal band, and they gave him a bass drum to play. A little boy carrying around this bass drum. He also later was upgraded to euphonium. This doesn't seem to be working very well.
It is.
Really? Okay. Okay. So things, he actually started looking up as far as their state of poverty, and they were living in a small one-room apartment, he, his sister, and his mother. He had his salary was 50 pesos a month, and they lived on that, which was barely enough for the f- for the family. And then he started composing music for the band in the Army and arranging music for the band in the Army. And then things started looking up until the big tragedy of his life struck. He contracted leprosy. And he was sent to live in a leper colony that was managed by the Salesian priests. It's called Agua de Dios. And he was offered comfort, home. They gave him a piano. And he lived the rest of his life there. And since he had a piano, that's the majority of his music is piano music. So the selection that I've chosen today is called Lejano Azul, which means far away blue. I hope you enjoy it.
Thank you.
have heard for years that visitors here find this church very friendly. Not everybody, of course, but many. It is not unusual at all to hear a new member say that the first time they came here on a Sunday morning, people who'd been members for a while approached and wanted to know who they were and how they got here. Sometimes those members even asked if they could help the visitor find their way around the campus or even find their way into their place in the congregation. Stories abound about people who've been greeted their first Sunday here by Dale Povenmire. And then how Dale and Marilyn would invite visitors over to their house on their first Sunday here. All this is to say that the hospitality shown by this congregation does not go unnoticed by visitors or by your minister. A friendliness seems easy enough, doesn't it? At least for raging extroverts. You just walk up and introduce yourself, no big deal. On the other hand, I guess you can do friendly for the wrong reasons. And when you do, it's as phony as it sounds, and it sets off alarms for the people you approach. You know, if our welcome table was all about the task of twisting people's arms to become members so that our membership numbers would look good, then that wouldn't be very welcoming. And I think that would be good enough reason for you to consider not joining this church. But the people at the welcome table, I hope, don't care so much about what the numbers look like. And so I don't think they're twisting any arms, at least as far as I know. They're not offering free tickets to heaven or get out of hell free cards. The welcome folks are trying to greet the people who come to us. The membership committee is trying to make sure newcomers and visitors get connected to other people and get what they're needing out of coming here. Certainly, the whole welcoming table process has had a bit of a hard time recently, with so many members and friends and potential visitors staying so close to home somewhere else because of the pandemic. But I think it's precisely because the world is such a mess that it's so important that people who seek some semblance of sanity here can find it. Now, maybe you think being friendly isn't enough. Maybe you have a mind to start proselytizing all of a sudden. Maybe you've seen the light and those tongues of flame have landed on you and you've become a Unitarian Universalist evangelist, ready to go forth and tell random people out on the street that you've found a place where people can come together and there's a message of hope in today's world where so much seems so hopeless to so many. Just think about it, if you would. But really, is friendly enough? Lots of people are friendly, but not everybody who's friendly is hospitable, meaning that not everybody will take you in, no matter who you are or where you find yourself on the path. Going beyond friendly, hospitality is about generously providing care and kindness to whoever is in need of it. I think we do our best here to practice hospitality, putting on the best programming we can for the community, both this community and the broader one, engaging in social justice efforts, welcoming people the best we can on Sunday mornings. But what we really might be about goes even a step further than simple hospitality. The late theologian Letty Russell called this, a little step further, just hospitality, which she said is the sort of openness to difference that goes beyond mere tolerance of another's idiosyncrasies and beyond mere acceptance of the fact that we're all different people from different places with different experiences. Just hospitality, in the late Dr. Russell's parlance, is the practice of remembering, taking in, caring for, and supporting the different, the dispossessed, the oppressed, the misunderstood, and then reshaping a beloved community that accounts for, draws out, and celebrates all those differences. I know that Letty Russell's name is not a household one. I did not know her personally, but Sally Clark, our office administrator here, did. Sally worked for Letty and her mother at Yale. Sally is still friends with Letty's wife, Shannon, stayed with Shannon the last time she visited in the North. Sally will tell you she owes quite a lot to Letty Russell. Myself, I was thrilled to read Letty Russell's groundbreaking work in feminist theology while I was in seminary. Her writings taught me new ways of reading old texts, sacred and not, not simply to look at the words on the page, but to read between the lines and behind the print, to tease out the history and the context and the hidden meanings in all of that. Dr. Russell, as one of the first women admitted to Harvard Divinity School, was at heart a biblical theologian, a feminist one, but a biblical theologian to the core. So I would not be doing her memory justice if I didn't share with you the biblical foundation she found for her ideas about this just hospitality. I do realize that September from this pulpit has been fairly biblical. September is almost over. Now, Russell used as her biblical bookends the stories of the Tower of Babel and the visitation of the Spirit on Pentecost. The Tower of Babel story comes from the mythic prehistory recounted in Genesis early in the Bible. It is mythic rather than historical. It addresses the question of why there are different cultures and different languages around the world. It comes after the story of Noah and the Great Flood and prefigures the story of Abraham and Sarah and Hagar. Here's a quick paraphrase of Genesis 11. Now the whole earth had one language and the same words. And as they migrated from the east, they came upon a plain and settled there. And they said to one another, "Come on, let's build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens so that we can make a name for ourselves. Otherwise, we shall be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth." The Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the mortals had built and said, "Look, they're one people and they have all one language. And this is only the beginning of what they will do. Nothing they propose to do now will be impossible for them. Let's, who's this Lord talking to? I thought there was only one God." You see how close reading like Russell's works. "Let's go down and confuse their language so that they will not understand one another's speech." So the Lord scattered them from abroad from there over the face of the earth. They left off building their city. The place was called Babel because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth and scattered them all over. Now the more orthodox take on this story is that it is about the advent of misunderstanding among people at the dawn of human history, and that the imposition of different languages on the people was a punishment from God for the sin of trying to be like God and reach all the way up to heaven. Letty Russell turns this on its head, seeing it rather as a story of the liberation of the nations that possess their own races, languages, families. And Russell even takes it a step further. We, like the tower builders, she says, continue to struggle with difference. Difference of race, ethnicity, gender, age, orientation, language, culture. But differences like these are not problems to be solved and controlled by some dominant group. Rather, they are important ways of assuring that the gift of a riotous diversity in all creation will continue. In fact, these differences are gifts in themselves. This wonderful gift lets new voices be heard, lets languages remain alive, lets cultures of all kinds flourish. Clearly, for Russell, the diversity imposed at this Babel is and continues to be a gift in itself. Now to Russell's other bookend, a story found in the book known as the Acts of the Apostles. It's the story of Pentecost. It's paraphrasing Acts chapter 2. When the day of Pentecost had come, the followers were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house. Divided tongues, as of fire, appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each. All of them were filled with the Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. And at this sound, a crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one had heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? How is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language?" Now, the Orthodox understanding of Acts is that God came down and repealed the punishment that had been inflicted on humanity back at the Tower of Babel by setting these tongues of flame on his followers. But Russell's reinterpretation of this story of Babel, of the story of Babel earlier, caused her to reevaluate the story of Pentecost as well. The important point in this story, she said, is not that image of the tongues of flame, but the fact that all those who had been made to speak different languages so long ago had been gathered into one human community where different languages are still spoken, but everybody understands each other. The main point then is the new understanding possible among disparate people. Russell says that at Pentecost, and I quote, "Unity is made possible by the gift of the Spirit that enables people of all nations to understand one another, no matter what language is spoken. The book of Acts says that each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. It does not say that people no longer had their own languages and customs, but that they could understand one another even in their difference." This is a very different kind of world, she says, from the one envisioned by the builders at Babel. And in this new world, the unity comes not from building a tower of domination or uniformity, but through communication. Thank you, Letty Russell. Communication is hard work. Just hospitality is hard work, too. As Letty Russell wrote, in the hard work of hospitality, we discover that although there are among us real differences of race, age, gender, orientation, these differences are not a problem to be solved or resolved. It's not those differences between us that are separating us. It is rather our refusal to recognize our differences. So let's recap. Just hospitality is not about simply being friendly to people, just like ourselves, who grew up in similar circumstances, who travel in the same circles, who enjoy the same symphonies. And it isn't about simply welcoming the people who find their way through these doors. You know it can't be limited to that. If you look and see how many people there are out there who either live here now or who will be moving into all these new houses very soon, but will never take the chance to come here. Just hospitality requires a willingness to think beyond the high walls of class and culture and personal preference that we've constructed, ostensibly to keep ourselves safe, I suppose. In fact, it requires the opposite of walling ourselves in. It requires an attitude of openness to the world and a receptivity of our own hearts to the hearts of others. It's hard work, and it's heart work, this hospitality stuff, and we sometimes get some of it right. But not all. For all of our aspirations to do better, sometimes we talk past each other. Sometimes we minimize or ignore the differences between us. Sometimes we fail to pay attention to the ways we are different and unique. Sometimes we expect too much of each other. Possibly because we are human. Possibly because we don't like to admit that we have any limitations at all. There are still, though, people who come through our doors and don't feel welcome once they're inside. There are still people who feel actively excluded by us because of who they are, or where they find themselves on their path, or because we don't see them well enough or pay enough attention. There are still people, I believe, that we consider strangers rather than neighbors. But as it is written in the 13th chapter of Hebrews, by welcoming strangers, we may entertain angels unawares. Just hospitality calls us to the heart work of remembering and taking into account not only the people just like us, but the different and the dispossessed and the oppressed and the misunderstood, both among us and in the broader community. And then working to reshape this culture we have built around us that we love so, reshaping that into a beloved community. Heart work may be hard work, where better to practice. So may it be. Our last hymn is number 159. This is my song to the tune of Finlandia. So I'd invite you to rise up as you are willing and able, as you wish. Benediction has been attributed to St. Francis of Assisi. Where hate rules, let us bring love. Where sorrow, joy. Let us strive more to comfort others than to be comforted, to understand others than to be understood, to love others more than to be loved. For it is in giving that we receive, and in pardoning that we are pardoned. Go in peace, walk softly on your paths, and may the light of love shine on you all your days.